You look at it!
I
look at it! Look at it! Look at it! Look at it! I want all of you to look at it!
Ubisoft Star Wars Outlaws reviews are out, and the gameplay has been broadcasted for all to see. And oh boy, was it not a surprise to us gamers how soulless this game really is. From NPCs having the classic ragdoll fits, or their behaviours acting like they don't know where they are, to the characters' silhouettes showing lack of or no emotions whatsoever when interacting with others, and the environment when it comes to high price hikes.
Do you think we're wealthy?
Hello, I'm Ux15, and let's dive into this stupidity. Now that Ubisoft have allowed reviewers to play the game at their headquarters, the verdicts are now in, and it's not looking good at all. So let's compare and dive into and see where it all went wrong. Just to say, I'm not a hardcore Star Wars fan, but that dreadful Force Awakens is what made me stop watching it altogether, and you'll see the reason why in this review. Meet Kay, the new Han Solo, who is only a street rat and gets in over her head and winds up on the bounty list by Zerek Barsh. Oh, and by the way, none of the trailers or gameplay tells us why. All we can go by is a heist gone wrong. But instead of keeping low and finding a way out, nope, she wants to pull off the biggest heist to be a notorious outlaw the galaxy has ever seen. All of a sudden, that is. Because what's a girl boss story without some trial or major conflict in a woman's life, and it happens to be an evil white man? But remember, Kay has no past experience of being an outlaw or bounty hunter. She has not gone to planets around the galaxy, let alone knows how the criminal underworld really works. But for some reason, her body can withstand thermal detonators, she has kitty cat punches that can knock out stormtroopers, and has great driving skills that can make an experienced pilot dazed and confused. Oh, and has gunslinger reflexes on standby if the player takes too long in laser combat. In this universe, in another Star Wars galaxy far, far away, Kay is perfect at everything, and everybody else are morons. She gets the big jobs just like that, even though for some strange reason, none of the criminal warlords know who she is. She does have a bounty on her head, right? But a case of minutes into the game, she has gone from simple street rat to Han Solo 2.0, having the best aim and the best driving skills. Whoever wrote this story is clearly someone has either never had real life experience or is a flat out Tumblr fanfiction writer. Again, if Sliro, head of Zerek Barsh, has put a bounty on Kay, Kay going into the criminal underworld with no experience, resources or connections will spell Minecrafted. The moment she's on the criminal warlord's turf, let alone doorstep, she would be killed in seconds, as criminal warlords are only interested in the almighty credit. Once they see a grand opportunity for easy big credits, they will take it, no hesitation. But again, this is the Moron Galaxy where everybody suddenly gets amnesia, except Kay. But who is the one that gave Kay this ridiculous idea to go from common street rat to an outlaw to get out of this hot water? Meet Jalen Varx. Wait a minute, he looks so familiar. He looks just like Kyle Katarn from the Jedi Knight 2 Outcast game I played on the GameCube when I was a teen. Jesus, they can't do anything original, can they? He's an outlaw himself, who has been running heists of his own. He is the one who plants the seed in Kay's gullible mind, in order to stop Sliro's bounty request of being one of the most wanted people in the galaxy and no longer having to look over her shoulder. Rob all of Zerek Barsh's fortune in order to get her freedom back from their pursuit of her. Let's say if Kay did manage to pull it off, this is not going to stop the bounty, it's just going to increase it even further. I might be wrong, but there's so many clues to this theory. Kay will get the job done and Jalen will stab her in the back and try to take her fortune for himself, and Kay will still take the fall. As of course, white men can't be trusted, don't you know? Man, it's so obvious how this story will go when it screams Tumblr fanfiction with an agenda. When it comes to the alliance system, it would make sense if your relationship with a certain criminal syndicate is poor or bad. They don't want you on their territory, let alone you'll be on their watch list. However, when it comes to the cutscenes, it's either they act like they have forgiven you, or flat out play dum-dum and trust you anyway. It would be better that if you get caught in their territory, you have a hit squad that would try to murder you. Yeah, Ubisoft being lazy to detail as always. Of course, it wouldn't be Star Wars without starship fights, but nah, it just looks like mini-games and looking for treasure. Nothing special. But as video gamers, we always pay attention to detail when it comes to video games, and never give our money to companies that give us crappy products. So how bad is this game before we buy it? Well,
it's high noon. Draw. Draw.
To business. Good.
Well, I know you're a busy pike.
Governor Thornton and the Don are attempting to remove me from power. They were her. And Kay, I want my ring back.
Oh, you lost a ring. Was it worth something? Or...
You're lucky I need you. Get moving!
Quite ironic, the aliens have more detail put onto them than the humans do. And that says an awful lot. How many double standards are there really? Even though they have the tech to push it further. Because of course, DEI quotas have to be met. Can't be Ubisoft without them. There are so many bad takes, but I'm going to be here all day. When we look at the designer Kay, you know from the get-go they manified her on purpose. The model, Kimberly Gonzalez, is a beautiful looking lady. But seeing what they did to her says everything. Gotta get those DEI points by making women ugly as always. Oh, and holy cow, they chest binded her as well to keep the modern audience happy. That is nowhere to be found. But when you look at her clothing, I swear I've seen it somewhere.
Oh dear, how sad.
But what really puzzles me is, if this is the end product, then where did the rest of the budget go? Because saying that this is the gameplay graphics of a GameCube game is an insult to the road console itself. But surely with a crappy game like this, the money went somewhere else. I wouldn't be surprised if all the budget went to cinematics, long trailers, DEI consultants and buttering up reviewers. Because of course, it wouldn't be Ubisoft by giving all of its money to hustlers than to the actual product itself. The thing that a lot of people don't talk about is the message itself. Ubisoft thinks everyone is stupid. They flat out lied to investors, saying gamers and Star Wars fans love the game. They have a community manager that is so loving and tolerant, oh, never mind. Again, it can't be Ubisoft if you hate white male leads. Quite ironic that the white male is the villain that wants you dead, as a black flat-chested. There are so many shills to give good reviews, which doesn't even make a dent against gamers or YouTubers. But what's more laughable is that they're digging so deep to find those hidden gems, knowing full well there is no cave for wonders beneath the game's surface, and getting ratioed to high heaven is the cherry on top. Ubisoft ultimately have the audacity to think multi-million IP sellotaped to six already made game elements around like a ball and a bucket full of soulless content sprinkles means easy money. If I was an investor, I would seriously pull out now and ask so many questions of why the marketing budget needs to be really high in the first place, if the world itself already knows what Star Wars is. To give you a history lesson on how to make a timeless masterpiece and show you back when there were so many limitations compared to today, take Final Fantasy X, a game that was released in July 2001 for the PS2. With a budget of $59.1 million in today's money, took 100 people to make the game, and it took roughly 2 years. As of 2023, it's grossed $17 billion, making it the highest selling title of the Final Fantasy series. When we look at Final Fantasy X, you can instantly tell the creators made it with passion and tender loving care. They took attention to detail very seriously. From the animations, like how the characters' mouths are moving, body language and eyebrow expressions, the characters' established behaviours and backstories, their outfits, the world of Spira, enemy designs, the whole lot. Even though Square were already a famous and established company, they knew if they didn't make timeless classics, it always spelt disaster for them in the end. Also, blaming their audience for their own mistakes is plain stupid and narcissistic. When it comes to timeless classics, they can always be remastered and re-released, like famous fairy tales or novels. It's a no-brainer. By them having a big follower base and all the money made from their own IPs, showing they deserve it for all their hard work.
There's also some real emotional moments that are very memorable in it, where Tidus finds out some information about Yuna that is shocking to him, and he has to deal with it. Because he has no other choice but to deal with it. And if he wants to be a hero, he's got to take on these responsibilities and these emotions. And they're new emotions for him. But he handles them well. And it's a breathtaking scene as well. The animation in this, literally, when I first saw it, we had to spend some time where we had to stop for a while where I was going, this is amazing animation. I kept just saying over and over, I can't believe this animation. I would say to the people that are playing this game and have played all of the other Final Fantasy games that this is, in my opinion, the most exciting, the most visually stunning, and to take the time to go through and get every aspect of the game. Now, it could take hours and hours, but it's going to be a lot of fun, and it's a learning experience, it's a growth, and you know, not to sound corny, but you'll learn, and you can become possibly a better person because this character, Tidus, he learns and he becomes a better person through it. And if you can really get involved in the story and get wrapped up in it like most of us do, I get involved in stories, you should grow from it as well.
I think you have to go into it with an actor head because these mics and this whole system is so sensitive that every nuance to your voice is going to be heard and you can't make your voice sound like you're thinking. You have to think and then your voice will just do it. It's a lot more organic, I think, than we would initially assume. And it's even something that I've discovered as I go about doing this. So I try to relate myself to the character that I'm portraying. In this case, you know, I relate myself as best I can to Yuna. I haven't saved the world lately, so that dimension of her escapes me a tiny bit. But what elements that are there that are very specific and human, and at the same time general and identifiable. I try to tap into those elements, think it through from that perspective, and then my voice reflects what I'm thinking, what I'm feeling, without even trying. So when you force it, it's obvious. When you just do it, it's gonna be a lot more enjoyable for you and for the listener. If I had one thing I'd like the gamers to take away in this movie's experience would probably be that, an experience. I want them to get lost in the story. I want them to get lost in these characters. I want them to forget they're playing a game. I want them to participate like they're right there having it happen. And I hope that through our voices, through this animation, through this storytelling, we're able to just transport them into a completely different world. Right there in Spira.
But what about Star Wars Outlaws? Star Wars took 600 staff from all around the world from different Ubisoft companies. The budget? We don't know yet. But Ubisoft boasts it is the biggest ever marketing budget, so we know this is going to cost way over 59.1 million. But rest assured, Ubisoft said it will have a strong launch expected, which is laughable. This game took 4 years to make. 4 years, and this is the feedback that we're getting. Did you think Ubisoft would delay this abomination to fix the bugs? Nope, it ain't happening. The release date is locked in.
Kvass is a thief. She's a scoundrel. She's really good at sneaking around. You know, she's charming and she'll like talk to you, but she's already taking all your things. She isn't perfect at it, but she always seems to get away with it.
Return of the Jedi, so it's the civil war between the rebellion and the Empire. That has actually created this pocket of opportunity for syndicates and criminal organizations to rise up in that space. We've got the Pikes, we've got the Hutts, we've got a new syndicate that we've crafted for this game called the Ashiga Clan.
I know that people are gonna love this game, not just for how amazing the gameplay is, but like the story itself, to see a young girl become a woman and become an outlaw.
What, are you worried?
No.
We worked with Lucasfilm every step of the way in crafting the story, and they were an invaluable partner in helping us create and craft this thing. They were really embracing us with open arms in terms of, hey, we want to focus on the underworld. We want to focus on an outlaw navigating through that space. But we're sort of there to help guide and point out, like, hey, here's an opportunity you might not have looked at, or there's a character you might want to consider. So really, it was a partnership through and through.
No mention of the graphics or animations. The voice actor Gonzalez doesn't talk about how she conveys her voice or movements into the game, only talking about how much of a girl boss Kay can be. Or what's worse, the director, Kavari, doesn't talk about how the characters or the world of Star Wars that he has envisioned will become a relatable and memorable experience to the audience. Oh, saying that Lucasfilms, aka Disney, allowed him the freedom to do anything, no restrictions, is a big red flag immediately for hardcore Star Wars fans, meaning the law is going to change for the worse. Or possibly it will conflict the Star Wars story and its universe. But if the actor is not talking about the animations or how the game has affected them personally to give a grand performance, that's when you know the director and the developers have failed. We see it with the US voice actors for Final Fantasy X. They constantly talk about the animations, and upon seeing the characters, how they will use their voice to bring the character to life. So immediately upon seeing the graphical animations, they knew the bar was high and they had to give a memorable experience. Furthermore, you have the directors who go into absolute detail about the world of Spira itself, the different races, cultures and creatures who dwell there, and what world inspirations they used to create this genius masterpiece. Man, I wish we had trailers like this again. Upon comparing the two games, which game holds up superior? Of course, it will be the one who had the most passion and tender loving care. And okay, for people saying it has to be another Star Wars game to make my point, well, let's take a best-selling Star Wars game without any microtransactions or being a AAA title. Meet Star Wars: The Old Republic, released 20th of December 2011, with a budget of $200 million, with 665 people who worked on it, not including the voice actors by the way. But since 2023, only has 70 to 80 BioWare staff to work on this game. This game took 6 to 7 years to make, but it's made $1 billion in lifetime revenue. And apparently, it's still going strong and making millions. So how has this game survived for so long? Again, because it's made with tender loving care and paying attention to detail. This game was made for Star Wars fans and video gamers together. Yeah, the graphics need a major update and the fighting system is clunky, but it's doing a lot better than other MMOs today. If the product is not made for video gamers, let alone made by people who have the passion and give it tender loving care, the gamers will not buy it. Simple as that. Ubisoft can gaslight, guilt trip, their core audience all they like, but they will just speedrun their company into the ground further. It will be interesting to see the launch of Star Wars Outlaws and see how bad it will do, as it's inevitable at this point. But I sure know one thing, Ubisoft are not getting a penny out of me, because if buying a Ubisoft game means you don't own it, then pirating isn't stealing, as they say. This is Wilkes of 15, signing out.
And why is that bag on your head?
Why? Oh, no reason. Except you gave me the ugly! Well, what am I gonna do? I can't go out looking like this!